Hi everyone, I'm Ashish and I will be presenting how to build a scale-out multi-node NAS using NFS v4 concepts like REFLs and SudoFS with my colleague Surat. Before starting, let me give a brief introduction of myself. Currently, I'm working at Nutanix Technologies from last 2.5 years. My earlier employers include Mapr Technologies and Samsung Technologies. I have around 12 years of software development experience, primarily in the storage domain. Nutanix, which is my current employer, is consistently considered as the leader in hyperconverged infrastructure from last several years. We have been helping our customers transition from the traditional multi-tiered siloed data center to much more efficient and advanced hyperconverged infrastructure. Besides our core HCI product, we have a portfolio of other products which are natively built inside Nutanix's cluster. And one of our product is a NAS solution, which we call Nutanix Files. Me and Surud are part of Files team. And what we are presenting here is somewhat similar in terms of the concept which we use in our product. If you wish, you can visit our company's website, Nutanix.com, to check out the list of complete offerings we have. We have divided this presentation in two parts. I will be covering the first three parts from the agenda, and Surud will cover the rest of the parts. First, I will briefly talk about the problem statement. Then we will touch upon NFS v4 concepts like REFLs and SudoFS with an example of each. After that, I will give a brief introduction of the components used in creating NFS v4 NAS, which includes the open source NFS Ganesha server and Apache Zookeeper. Surud will talk us through the configuration and design of the multi-node NAS and finally combine all the pieces and learning to build a NAS server. So the problem statement is how to build a software-defined, load-balanced, scale-out NAS solution that could span multiple nodes and export a single namespace over NFS v4 by using the open-source NFS Ganesha server and a distributed database like Zookeeper. All the nodes are registered with a single DNS name, and client can connect to any node in the cluster to access the data. In general, there are two ways to stitch a namespace spanning across multiple nodes. The first way is hosting the protocol server on a clustered file system spanning across multiple nodes. Here, the client does not need to know the physical location of the file system and all the complexity, which includes fetching the requested data from a remote node, is handled by the server, or rather the clustered file system. This type of solution has a disadvantage of an extra call to be executed from the node receiving the request to the one which is hosting the target file system. Now, one way to mitigate this disadvantage is to have cache of the recently accessed data on the remote node. But that also requires a distributed cache coherency and distributed locking in case there are multiple copies of same data cached on different nodes. This type of implementation is best suited for stateless protocols like NFS v3, which does not have support for REFLs. Big NAS players like EMC and NetApp have been doing this from several years. The other way to perform the stitching is with the help of the client, where the client can connect to the multiple nodes based on the location of the file system which it is trying to access. This has an advantage of reducing the number of RPC calls among the host nodes. The server implementation in this case is greatly simplified without any need of clustered file system. This slide here talks about how the exports are viewed at the client side and touch upon the concept of SudoFS in NFS v4. So there are two main versions of the NFS protocol used in user deployments, V3 and V4. So in case of NFS V3, there are multiple file server and shares available. It requires the client and hence the user to be aware of the names of each server and individually mount each share. This could quickly become a hassle if you have lots of file server nodes and hundreds of shares. A commonly used mechanism to simplify this is AutoFS, which allows servers and shares to be made available on an as-need basis as they are traversed in a designated namespace. For example, if server 1 and server 2 are exporting shares, share 1 and share 2 respectively, a Linux client can use the default AutoFS configuration to access the shares at, let's say, NAT server 1 share 1 and NAT server 2 share 2 respectively. NFS V4, on the other hand, defines the concept of a pseudo file system that allows a single namespace to be built from among all the exported shares on the server. So the advantage of this thing is you don't need to remember the names of the individual shares. For example, if the server exports AB and XYZ as two separate shares, the client can connect to slash, which is the root of the exported tree, and traverse through slash A, slash B, and slash X, slash Y, slash Z without being exposed to other contents of the paths. Now, this here is an example of how NFS V4 pseudo-FS are viewed at the client side. Consider the case where the server wants to export two directories, which are colored in gray on the left-hand side. Previously, in NFS V3, the clients were forced to mount each share separately. With V4, the server constructs a pseudo file system structure that contains only directories that lead to the exports. Thus, the client view of the server namespace is limited to the paths that lead to the exported file system. So, in this figure, you can see that a shared and public exports are the exported file system. So, once you mount the NFS V4 root of the export tree, on the client, the paths that are visible will be slash AFS root slash shared and slash AFS root slash projects slash public. So the other directories, which are like payroll and secrets, are not visible at the client side. This here describes an NFS V4 referral example in detail. In this example, the single namespace is federated among three different machines, FSVM1 through FSVM3, each one physically hosting one share and having IP addresses, IP address 01 through IP address 03. The three machines collectively have a single DNS name called fs01.domain, while each machine also have a unique DNS name. Following the sequence of events, client mounts the root of the NFS V4 export tree using the collective DNS name. The DNS resolver will resolve this name to three available IP addresses, and client will pick one address based on the round robin mechanism to mount the root of the export tree. In the current example, it picks up IP address 1. So when client does an LS on the export route, the readdir RPC will reach FSVM1 and client will see all three exports, even though FSVM1 is only hosting export 1. Surud will talk us through later on how this is achieved, but for now we can assume that each FS node knows about all the exports and their physical location, and it can correctly reply to the readdir RPC on the pseudo FS route. Now, when the client will try to step into one of the export which is not local to FSVM1, for example, export 3, it will issue a lookup RPC and the NFS server running on FSVM1 will return error emote. This is a special error which signifies that the directory which the client is trying to access is not physically hosted on this machine. On getting this error, client send getter RPC and asks for referral location, which is known as FS locations. Server will return the host's DNS node name, which is FSVM3 in this case, and the path of the target directory on the host node. The node name will be converted to IP address by doing a DNS query. Client will send a lookup and getter RPCs to the correct node and submount export 3 in its namespace. After that, all the subsequent RPCs for export 3 will reach FS node 3. NFS Ganesha is an open source user mode file server for different NFS protocols with an active developer community. It has a layered architecture and accesses the underlying data through a file system abstraction layer called FSL, allowing developers to plug in their own storage mechanism and access it from NFS client. It has admin bus, which use dbus mechanism to perform administration tasks like create export, delete export, etc. It has a logging infrastructure where you can specify the logging target either as a file or as a syscuttle infrastructure. You can even use LTTNG for tracing with NFS Ganesha. In essence, Ganesha server comprises of different layers of software. The top layer mentioned as network channel in this diagram is the entry point of the RPC. It receives and sends data to and fro between client and server and handles socket FDs and epoll FDs. Ganesha is a multi-threaded application and it uses thread pool to execute these RPCs. Once the entire request is read in by the network channel, the role of the RPC dispatcher is to find an idle thread and dispatch the request to the chosen thread while the current thread will continue reading further data from the socket. The above two layers are part of the transport independent RPC layer called libNTI RPC. After that, the RPC enters the server RAM and it is checked against duplicate request and gets authenticated in case of KRV5 security flavor. Once that is done, the actual protocol specific code comes into picture, which checks the sanity of the request according to protocol spec. For example, it checks if the arguments and values are valid or not, or if there is already some state, then if the current RPC breaks any of the state rules, etc. Once the RPC is validated, it needs to be executed. Ganesha does not execute the request on its own. Instead, it has an abstraction layer which separates the protocol server from the executor part. This abstraction layer, known as the file system abstraction layer, is a classic example of the usage of well-defined function pointer-based APIs to maintain separation between two layers. In this case, the protocol server layer will call the functions which are actually implemented by custom facade layer based on the underlying storage. The caching in Ganesha is itself implemented as a separate facade layer, which is also stackable, such that other facades can sit below the caching facade. The caching facade caches metadata like file handles, attributes, and directory entries, etc. Below the caching facade sits the developer's custom implementation of the facade, which does all the work of fetching required data from underlying storage. NFS Ganesha uses AVL tree and hash tables to cache various sets of data like handles, attributes, FSIDs, states, etc. You can find more information about NFS Ganesha from the link mentioned in the first line of the PPT. Now the other component which we will be using to build the NAS solution will be Apache ZooKeeper. So Apache ZooKeeper is a centralized service for maintaining configuration information, providing distributed synchronization and group services for distributed applications. ZooKeeper also distribute process to coordinate with each other through a shared hierarchical namespace of data registered called as Znodes, much like that of a standard file system. ZooKeeper provides its clients with high throughput, low latency, high available, and strictly ordered access to the Znodes. The diagram here is a basic architecture of ZooKeeper, where the ZooKeeper service is comprising of various server nodes, where one of the server is elected as a leader and all the server act as slaves. The clients can talk to any of the server, and it is guaranteed that the data will be consistent when the client is accessing it. So for the sake of building our NAS solution, we actually don't need to go into the detail of Zookeeper. What we need is just the usage scenario, how to ingest and digest the data out of a Zookeeper service. So it's not even required to use Zookeeper. Any of the distributed database system will do. If you are not comfortable with Zookeeper, you can use any other database like a Cassandra or a MongoDB also. Now for the next part of the slide, I will hand over to Surud, and he will walk over the configuration and give an example of how the NAS is built.
Hello everyone. I'm Surud from Nutanix Files team. So let's continue using the concepts what Ashish discussed and try to build a system. So what we have here is basically we have a N-node cluster. The Ganesha service is running on each node. So Ganesha service itself is not a clustered solution. So the Ganesha running on node 1 does not know about Ganesha service running on node 2 and likewise. Similarly, the file system I have is also not a clustered solution. So they are independent file systems. But what we want here is if the client comes from node 1, it should still see all the three shares. Similarly, a client coming from node 2 should see all the three shares. That is what we want to achieve here. So for that, what we're doing is each node will have a path like for each share. So basically something like my shares, share A, B, and C, out of which only one path is a real path. So node 1 will have a share A path as a real share path, and share B and share C are basically just empty directories. Similarly, node 2 will have only a real path for share B, and other two are empty directories. So this is done basically to make Ganesha config happy. So it needs some directory where it can anchor the share root. It needs to know where my share is present. So this makes all the shares or all the exports available from all nodes. So what we do is if any access comes from for a specific share, then basically Ganesha service will check into Zookeeper. It will find out the owner node where the share is actually present, and then it will refer to the client to the specific node. So this is one time activity. Once the referral happens, all client access will go to the specific node. So for example, going back here, let's say client mounts from node 1 and it is trying to access share B. Then for the first time access, the Ganesha service on node 1 will refer the client to node 2. And after that, the client referral will start using node 2, and client will essentially use access share B from node 2. So this helps us achieve scalability. So as the number of shares increase, we have them distributed across multiple nodes, and each node contributes to share access. Basically, one share is accessed through only one node, but as the number of shares is high, they can scale across all the nodes. Now with NFS v4, we need to support a read dir on sudo root. So that means all the nodes must be able to support read dir operation and list all the shares. This also requires the Ganesha service on every node to be able to create a root file handle. That also requires some information. So this basic information for every share is maintained into Zookeeper. So the Zookeeper map essentially looks like this. So it has every share name, and it has information about which node is actually owning the share. And it also has stats for that share. So this stats is used to generate the read dir plus information for the specific share. So this allows us to support read dir on sudo root, and that completes the NFS v4 access. So any read dir operation is served by all nodes, and when you specifically access a specific share, the client gets referred to the owner node. So in that case, let's say share A will always be accessed through node A. So in summary, this is how we build a clustered or a single namespace without actually using a clustered NFS service or a clustered file system. And since the client's IO get distributed at node level, that achieves us the scalability. Thank you all for your time. Thank you very much.